You're listening to Tune Dig, a podcast for music lovers. The premise is simple. We dig into an album to discover what makes it interesting, and then we dig into the crates for a vinyl copy to give away to one lucky winner.
Go to tunedig.com for your chance to win, and follow us on Instagram and Twitter for more info about the album that didn't make the episode.
Today we're talking about Voodoo by D'Angelo.
So here we find ourselves at another finale, and we have maybe accidentally, maybe unconsciously, backed ourselves into another record that is a huge moment. So to run it back down, our finales thus far have been A Love Supreme by Coltrane, Miseducation of Lauryn Hill, and Purple Rain. Season 4, talking about Voodoo, which dropped January 25 of 2000 and should have dropped a lot earlier than that. Arguably, maybe not. Was purported to, let's say, be released a lot earlier than that, but didn't.
We need to slowly get to an internal temperature of 165.
So the thing that I've been thinking about a lot, specifically with this record, but I think applies to all the other finale records that we've talked about, is time. Some transcendent quality across space and time that these records were attempting to achieve. And the question is, did all the mythology around this record, did everything that happened to make this record come to fruition, was it necessary? The question around it is, what does it take to make something timeless? And the story around this record is kind of the stuff of rock and roll lore. It was 4 years in the making, more or less. So it may or may not be the blueprint. It's just one example in a litany of other crazy rock and roll stories that you can tell. But one thing is for certain, when you go out and read other people's opinions, and they are voluminous, there is so much that you can read about this record, and the writing around it is so good, because inspiration begets more inspiration. It has a multiplier effect in that way. So love or hate how they got there, I think the argument is that the ends justify the means.
Certainly in comparison to the other timeless records that we talked about, Coltrane, Lauryn Hill, Prince, this has the lowest album sales to timelessness ratio in a way that almost hurts me deeply. This is a record that everyone should love, even if they don't appreciate it. I don't see what's not to like about this. And that makes me happy, because you rarely get the opportunity to see something that is both, using the term accessible here is almost painful, but to be able to get something this accessible and then also this musically dense and complex is a rare feat. I mean, even in John Coltrane's case, like, you know, we essentially had to make a case that it's worth getting into that record, even if you feel like it's too much for you. This is one you should be able to just sit down in a chair and turn on and get wherever you're at.
Or, like so many people have suggested, put it on in the background and it goes from ambient thing that you enjoy into, I want to run that back. Which Questlove, who's an integral part of this record and has been one of its biggest champions for the 20 years of its existence, said something to the effect of, most records are kind of either one thing or the other. You know, you got to either lean forward or lean back to enjoy it. And a bit miraculously, this record achieves both things really, really well.
Yeah, when he was talking about that particularly, he mentioned that in a way this, let's just say what he said, because I think it makes a lot of sense. He said, this record is too extreme to play the middle of the fence between background and foreground, between, you know, passive and active listening, essentially. But this is what I love about it. He wrote a review of a record that he's clearly on, which I love, first of all. But this comes from, you know, him writing this not too long after it was out. And so he's kind of going in on it. But he says, this record is the litmus test that will reveal the most for your personality. Cats who live for music and all the new directions it can show you have cried when I played this record. And he says, I don't want to embarrass no one, but I assure you at least 7 of your favorite artists were on their knees bawling because of this astounding document of music. He said, this is what we need today. This is no miseducation. This is the blueprint right here for them, which was a really weird composition of a sentence. But what he's saying is maybe it can be both, but not to an individual person.
Right.
This cuts, you're sitting on the razor and you got to choose one side or the other with this. And I think for us, which we were joking about before we started recording, is maybe one of, maybe we fall on the side of reverence about this record and intense active listening, because unfortunately spending this much time listening to it has made everything else sound really bad for a while now.
Yeah, after Fight Club, everything else in your life gets the volume turned down. When we get on a roll like this, I never get aware of it because I'm acutely in the joy of the moment. And I know that's kind of my whole personality, as you've pointed out to me so many times over the years. But I think about that AV club guy that called us relentlessly hyperbolic, I think. And if there's one time this season where that's warranted, it's D'Angelo's Voodoo. It's one thing, all right, we're two guys who aren't in bands. We've been around music forever, whatever. Us and people that write about music for a living are one thing. I remember the All About Jazz review. The guy said, send me the media kit, and got like a 50-page tome or whatever of all the critical reviews, and it's pretty breathless. Great. All these people are like, this record's dope, whatever. But the thing that was really telling for me was the promo video that they put out around the release, like part of the EPK. And you see all these people dropping by the studio. So to Quest point, like, he wasn't going to name names, but there are people in this video that you may or may not associate with this kind of music, and they're visibly blown away by what they're hearing. I mean, he has Eric Clapton down to the studio, who says something to the effect of, how much more, like, is it all like this? I can't take much more of this. Oh my God, this is incredible. And specifically, he plays One Mo' Gin for Rick Rubin and Chris Rock, who are just hanging out together in the studio. And it goes off, and Rubin goes, that's the shit. And this whole record, when you slip into the hot tub of it, and we can talk about the way that it sounds, how it creeps in on you like a smoke cloud or water or something that's very, like, very ethereal in a way, but in like the low end, it's a super syrupy record. When it dawns on you what is happening, the feeling that it's giving you is so unequivocal that, like, I just keep hearing that Rick Rubin thing looping in my head. Now, having watched Shangri-La, the documentary, and seeing how he responds when he realizes that something is the real thing, even of the many ways I've watched him respond to great artists making great music in that moment of the joy of creative spark, that's a unique response. To get Rubin that excited in that moment, it's a truly special thing. So I think, going back to the Coltrane connection, D worked really hard to make this happen. Also similarly to Prince, like, practiced the cut 1,000 times before making it. There's a very spiritual, transcendent quality. There's a reaching for something almost holy here. And he's a huge music nerd. There are 1,000 reference points. He's not trying to imitate, but emulate. And it gets up into up into that thing pulling up above the top of your head. There's like a real Holy Spirit thing happening. So I love that this record is called Voodoo, because it's very, there's something, man. There's a thing around it that's really, really, really special. And they crafted it perfectly to make it seem effortless and spiritual in that way.
I think that theme plays its way out because they seem to steep themselves in the history of what they were trying to appreciate instead of trying to reproduce it or even to create the next generation of something. Instead, they spent in their story after story of how much time they spent just listening to music in the space where they were recording it, then playing the music that they loved in old records, and then letting that actually organically create the things that would eventually become these songs. And I think you mentioned that EPK and like the video that's alongside it, like right at the beginning, you've got him walking in the street and he just says, "This is like a funk album. The natural progression of soul. The next step of soul is funk. Early slide, James Brown, funkadelic, when the music was just starting to change and the culture was changing." And it just kind of gets left there. He's not going anywhere with that statement. He's just telling you where his head's at. And it seemed like they found a good way to create a headspace. And he was comfortable sitting in it with all of these incredible musicians, obviously. And they were comfortable sitting there until it was fully baked, whatever that felt like and however long that took, with some semblance of real reverence and admiration for the people that came before them, but in a real, like, diasporic type of way. It's almost like producing the output was a lot less important than knowing that they were in the right headspace for whatever came out of it. And that's why this feels so organic. This blows me away every time, because they didn't intentionally go in to say, let's blow up song length, popular song structure in general. None of it's an actual reaction to any of the insane music that was actually popular when this record came out, but was instead like a, that's irrelevant.
Yeah, I have no interest in that. That's not the real thing. Yeah. That'll come and go.
Right.
Yeah. Which I think merits pointing out the cultural context. So in the 99 and the 2000, there was a lot of talk in the write-ups about your R. Kelly's and your Cisco's and your 120 plus BPM. Like, R&B had become club music. It had become pop. And this record went number one in 2000, but the other number ones in 2000 were NSYNC's No Strings Attached, Britney Spears' Oops, I Did It Again, Limp Bizkit's Chocolate Starfish and the Hot Dog Flavored Water.
Chocolate Starfish!
If only we could fly! Nelly's Country Grammar, Eminem's Marshall Mathers LP, Ja Rule's Rule 336.
So classic after classic so far.
Celine Dion's All the Way Greatest Hits album, Santana's Supernatural, and get this shit, Now 4. So, not to be like a classist about the thing, but it was kind of a spiritually bankrupt time in the music industry writ large. You know, it makes me appreciate the moment we're living in right now where, yeah, sure, there's a lot of music that sounds like an AT&T commercial, but living in the time when a Solange can go number one and a Kendrick Lamar can go number one and a Tyler, the Creator, can do really well in the charts. And even a Billie Eilish, who can go between that commercial and credible. We're really lucky to be living in like a 60s era time where, even though it's hell everywhere else, people are making really great art that also does really well commercially and penetrates the consciousness. That was not the case when this record came out. This record was sorely needed.
You know what, though? That's really interesting that you say that, because so Solange released a bunch of music when the 15th anniversary of this record?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So everyone that you just kind of rattled off, and I don't know if you were thinking about it this way, but all of those people, Kendrick, there's this knowledgeable connection to their musical ancestry.
Mm.
They have a clear and transparent appreciation for the music that came before them. And to me, that was one of my biggest takeaways from reading interview after interview about Voodoo, is that that was that headspace, right? When he talks about this being a funk record, he's talking about, yeah, there is music that sounds like funk from this. There's a lot of funkadelic influence in Sly and the Family Stone.
Mm-hmm.
They were holding their finger out and connecting with that moment in musical time. And I mean, literally, I mean, as we'll see from where and how they recorded this record, I mean, literally putting themselves in the physical context of the people that they wanted to connect with historically, people who weren't even alive anymore. And I think there's something to be said about that. And it's worth appreciating the moment we have in artists who are willing to look back and point out the history that they come from and the appreciation they have for the people who paved the way. And maybe this is fresh for me, actually, because in doing some of this, I listened to, I know that you said never bring up Michael Rapaport again on this podcast, but real quick.
You made it through that podcast episode? I started to listen to it and I was like, nope, can't do it.
Okay. Well, so this is like his favorite album,
right?
Voodoo is, right? One of the things he goes on about, so to speak, a little later as he starts talking about it and getting wound up, which I do respect his love of this record.
I
could have a conversation with him about this record and about the way he approaches it. But one of the things he goes on about is like that one of the reasons that he loved Tribe so much and one of the reasons he loved D'Angelo so much was that they always told you where they were coming from and what musical ancestry they appreciated. And he gives this example of like, you know, these days, even guitar players, and he brings up like John Mayer, he's like, you can't talk to a modern guitarist, no matter how old they are, how young they are, and have them go, Jimi Hendrix, who? I never listened to that before. But he's like, but nowadays you listen to kids in hip hop and you ask them who their idols are, and they're like, no, Lil Vert. Like, he was going off about this thing because he had talked to some young hip hop artists, and they were like, to be honest, I'd never really listened to a Wu-Tang record before.
I just listened to SoundCloud.
I think there were some there, so to speak. Like he was reaching into this thing where it's like there is something materially different about an artist who not only is able to tell you who he appreciates, but is able to physically connect their music and their headspace with the people that they want to emulate and talk about. And D'Angelo himself, along with everybody else who helped make this record with him, had no trouble going ahead and telling you, no, seriously, this is James Brown. This is Sly. This is Funkadelic.
It's Curtis Mayfield.
Yeah.
It's Fela Kuti. It's
Marvin Gaye.
It's Marvin Gaye.
Yeah.
Stevie Wonder. Yeah.
And there's something to that. And I think, sorry, I got amped because you kind of brought that up. And like, now that I think about it, there is a real thread to that. When music feels like we're in these moments that Voodoo put us in, and then some of the moments you're talking about now with some of these artists, like those are moments worth holding on to, and paying attention to our history, I think, is one of the things that makes us realize we can be in those moments.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas I don't remember hearing what drove Britney historically, you know, as an appreciation of her musical ancestors to release Oops, I Did It Again. If I may. Which, no Britney hate, I'm just saying.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, one's built for comfort, one's built for speed. I know we're going to get into the journey, the return to his roots moment that D'Angelo had to overcome writer's block and get inspired to make this record. But I thought Solange put it really beautifully in that assemblage of artists' quotes that she pulled together. She was breathless in her praise for the impact that Voodoo had on her life. That's like her record. That's her number one record, it seems like. And at the end of her write-up, she said, "It delivered me. It spoke for me. It made me feel right around the corner from my ancestors. It helped me to understand the woman I wanted to become." And that sense of right around the corner from my ancestors is so beautiful and so visual. And I think speaks to the power of this record and like the gospel connection and the way when we start talking about spirituality, like what we're really saying is that like sense of connection to the spirits and the, without getting to, we're all made of stardust and we're all different combinations of all the things that have come before us. That's what it is. Like, that's the thing that we're trying to evoke that we have a hard time talking about in words, that vibrations at a molecular level, that is what's happening in our bodies and in the air. And it's hard to articulate because we don't really understand the science of it quite that well yet, the quantum stuff. And we talked about that with the Coltrane episode, how mathematically it worked out that he was tapping into the same stuff that Einstein was tapping into with the theory of relativity. The same thing is happening here. There's like a hundreds of years of library archives built into the 80 minutes of this record. And that's what makes it feel so huge and monolithic. It's like stumbling into one of the seven wonders of the world, because it was a moment in time, but it contains all time within it. And that's as heady as I want to get on this episode. But that is to say, that feeling that you're feeling, that it goes way deeper than just the sounds you're hearing. It's because of that. It's because they worked to push all of that into their little time capsule. And it's this beautiful, it's not even a collage. It's an entirely new work of art in that way. All right. So we've talked about the environment that it was recorded, and we've alluded to it a couple of times. That place is Electric Lady Studios in Greenwich Village in New York. It was Jimi Hendrix's studio that he established in 1970. And the story of how Dee comes to find himself here is really interesting. So he releases Brown Sugar in 95. It's already a super against the grain record. Is one of the first records in what becomes known as the neo-soul movement in sort of the immediate ashes of the rise of the like native tongues, what would probably cringingly be called woke, like, or conscious culture back in the day, but just like thoughtful, artful, well-devised music that celebrates the Black experience.
And just to be really specific about it, when you say from the ashes of native tongues, like, members of the Soulquarians were literal members of native tongues, a lot of them, prior to this. So it's, again, it's got this thread of historical, ancestral positivity. It's just evolving into a new form here. And I think that itself is beautiful. The fact that we can point a finger directly back at the tribe episode and say, you know, not only is Q-Tip all over this record in general, but just like that movement and all the positivity that came with it, it was still alive. Mm-hmm. And it continued to be alive all over this record and all the other ones that would end up getting produced mm-hmm. in the same time span.
So Brown Sugar comes out in 95, and Voodoo doesn't come out until 2000. So arguably, Brown Sugar starts the quote-unquote neo-soul movement, which I still cringe at that term because it's a little too much of an umbrella for stuff that is really pretty different. So Maxwell puts out Urban Hang Suite in 96. Erykah Badu puts out Baduism in 97. Miseducation comes out in 98. All these records come out and have huge moments before there's a follow-up to Brown Sugar.
And don't forget, D'Angelo is on Miseducation.
Right, on the last song. Oh, nothing even matters. So this sort of movement is really starting to gestate in the collective consciousness. And in the interim, Dee has done 2 years of touring, and he's done some covers for soundtracks, and then crickets. So it turns out, as he comes to talk about in interviews, that he's had writer's block. How do you top this record? He's a noted music nerd and perfectionist. He only wants to make these like super classic monumental records, but he falls in love with Angie Stone, another super talented R&B singer, and has a kid. And much like Miseducation, that really changes your perspective on things and becomes a wellspring of creativity in that way. So that happens. He has a major hyperpersonal life event, and he also travels back to the South, spending some time in South Carolina and in his hometown of Richmond, Virginia. And there's a lot of talk about how he reconnects himself with the African-American musical history that originally inspired him. He said, I had to reiterate why I was doing that in the first place, and the reason was the love for the music. So, you know, I'm out on the road for a while. I've lost the thread. And it's amazing that after one album, like, he's such a pure student.
I mean, he's frustratingly pure as an artist.
Yeah. Like Andre 3000 level. Like, why can't you just be normal? And the kid in the backseat screaming that meme.
Yeah, but even worse, because he has the opposite experience of me in life, where D'Angelo keeps going through his career and accidentally being really sexy. And then being like, well, that's not what I meant. I'm going to back up for a while until people understand.
Yeah, stop telling me to take my shirt off. So it just so happens, which is it's still kind of mind-blowing to me, that Electric Lady Studio is like not really in use.
That was the wild part of the story to me.
Yeah.
Was just that Jimi Hendrix built a studio and no one is in it right now. What is everyone else doing that's more important than being in that studio?
Making the thong song. So credit to Russell Elevado, who was the recording engineer on this record and kind of the house guy at Electric Lady, apparently tipped D'Angelo off to the fact that it was still operational, available, and more or less untouched since its heyday, where the Rolling Stones and Stevie Wonder and people had produced classic albums in this space. Dee said, we were literally blowing dust off the Fender Rhodes that was in there. By the way, the Fender Rhodes that Stevie played on Talking Book and Music of My Mind, so NBD. He said, I was wiping dust off the microphones. So for a handful of years at the turn of the century, the Soulquarians treated Electric Lady as a clubhouse, a perpetual hang, unburdened by the usual ticking clock of the recording studio.
This is like trying to make a punk record that connects with the history of punk and finding out that CBGB's is totally pristine inside and fully available for you to move into.
Oh, and it's by the way, all the Ramones equipment is still on the stage and plugged in and operational.
That's fate level stuff.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Yeah, that's cosmic. So the Soulquarians took over all rooms at Electric Lady, and this is where I would pause to say Questlove's book, Mo Meta Blues, is a really great artifact. And I didn't reread it for this, but I read it a number of years ago before I really, really fell in love with Voodoo. But they're in every room. And Questlove talked about it from his perspective, running from recording to recording to play drums. They described it as a mood of urgent creative independence. Like there's so much fertile creativity happening. So four classic albums come out of this. Badu's Mama's Gun, The Roots as Things Fall Apart, Commons Like Water for Chocolate, and Voodoo. And Quest in the book was quoted as saying, like if you'd asked me at that period, he said, at first, to be honest, working on the new Roots album, Things Fall Apart, was a side dish for me. Voodoo was my main project. If someone had run into me on the street, I wouldn't have been able to stop talking about it, about the way that D'Angelo was going to revolutionize soul music and revitalize the very idea of soul, the way that it was going to permanently change the way audiences experienced recorded sound. There was such excitement, such a strong sense that it was going to be a landmark. So being able to hunker down in this space really gave them the ability to sustain that feeling of creative excitement. Just like imagine living in a world where we supported artists in that way, where they could just go and be for a while. Like to me, if we could get one more Voodoo out of that, that's a worthwhile return on investment. Common also said it was one of those time periods that you don't even realize when you're going through it that it's powerful, which is amazing. Just like really being in the moment and present. Quest said in his track by track review that you alluded to, he said, just being around these cats made me want to better my shit, and that jamming on songs inspired other new songs. We can get into that a little bit, but it was a time of wild mutual inspiration, as we talked about on Homogenic. I love how much we've referenced Björk throughout this season, but that's really the thread here, is that wild mutual inspiration among people who are all incredible in their own right.
This episode could be 6 hours long.
Yeah.
At least.
Yeah, yeah.
Just breaking down every individual musician.
So talk a little more about that. Talk about the personnel.
Certainly, I will end up missing somebody on accident, but the highlights that are, I think, worth individually starting to bring out here out of the Soulquarians as the backing band, which in and of itself is sort of a mind-blowing set of session musicians, but you'll start to see how they all worked together to build onto not only, again, a historical lineage of how music is played, but how they started to individually change one another's musical styles until they had essentially created something that was not in fact new, it was actually old, but felt new. It was in an entirely new context. So to me, the highlights of that are obviously Questlove and then Pino Palladino on the bass playing to Questlove. And so Pino Palladino is definitely the literal visible standout out of this band, what being tall and extremely Welsh. But we can talk about the ways that how Questlove played rhythmically allowed Pino Palladino to play differently on top of it in a way that would build on what jazz had done in the past, but feels like the fact that this is a soul record that is so jazzy is sort of the thing that's hard to talk about, right? And then on top of that, Charlie Hunter on guitar playing apparently a custom-made guitar with 5 guitar strings and 3 bass strings on it.
Yep.
And the musicianship is outrageous on all of these songs, which is part of what makes it, like, it's almost laughable, all of the narration you and I have already given to how, you know, finger quotes, important this record is to your appreciation of musical history. And yet that is not even the number one reason to just listen to this record. The number one reason is it's so good. Everything's so good about it. But I think one of the really important things to draw out of this, and there's more than enough to read on this, but it's really critical, I think, to pull it out and listen to it to appreciate what's going on Voodoo, is Questlove is dragging the beat. And that's maybe the key to unlocking a new level of appreciation for the musicianship on this record. So you hear that all over hip hop now, to the point to where it feels weird to have things in hip hop happening actually on the beat now because of how prevalent this has become. Now, to explain when I said this is not a new thing, but an old thing, this was happening in jazz already. Jazz drummers were, when we talk about dragging the beat, you're not literally playing on the beat the way that a drummer is literally supposed to do. That's kind of the entire point, right?
Think of a metronome.
Right. So D'Angelo is specifically asking Questlove, I want you to play to a click, but I want you to drag it on purpose.
You know, by the time that D'Angelo and I started the Voodoo record, which was like mid-96, that was the hardest thing ever because he constantly, like, he wanted me to drag the beat, but then he dragged the beat behind me. And so now I got to program my mind to think, okay, this is the metronome. And now he wants me to play. Which is, you know, I started having issues. Like, well, what if other drummers, like the musician community, is going to laugh at me? And he's like, nah, man, trust me. Like, use the force. He used all these Star Wars analogies with me. Like, use the force, man. And I'd never seen Star Wars, so.
And so you can really hear it once he starts explaining it that way. But then to build on top of that, which was sort of an extension not only of jazz, but then something that Tribe Called Quest and Nas were starting to do anyway in the late 90s. And then J Dilla, on top of that, was starting to integrate that sort of thing into his programming. So they're playing with rhythm already to give this a sort of uncomfortably off-kilter feel. But it's always, that's the hard part. It's always on rhythm in the sense that it's dragged the same amount behind the beat. So once you get used to it, you can feel it and hear it. So then Pino Palladino is coming in as a bassist, and D'Angelo had pre-sequenced a lot of the bass for him. And so, but is asking him to riff on top of that and to take whatever's there. And so now you've got Questlove dragging the beat, and then you've got Pino Palladino dragging that beat further to the point to where, like, some of my favorite, like, quips about this record were the people who were hearing about it later or who were asked to, like, maybe come in and collaborate on it as a lot of the music was already made. And they were basically like, this sounds bad, man. This is super sloppy. Like, I don't understand it, and I can't get
Q-tip
it.
Q-tip being one of those examples.
Yeah.
Yeah. He said the drums are messed up, the time is wrong. And then Lenny Kravitz was supposed to play guitar on a song. He said, I can't play with this. There's a discrepancy in the drum pattern. And they were like, it's supposed to be this way.
Well, better for him to say that than to get caught with his dick out, you know? I'm searching for words because of how important it is to communicate this concept as importance in this music, because this is part of that spiritual connection to the ancestry of funk. Because what it's doing is creating this sensation and feeling that you could describe as sloppiness if you're coming from the perspective of musical perfection. But what it's creating is a feeling that's loose, that not only wasn't happening in music at that time when things were becoming a lot more mechanical and overproduced anyway, but when you're trying to recreate the sensation of soul music before music became so mechanical and so quantized, basically, this was somehow a way that they fumbled into being able to recreate that feeling and sensation of that music. It's really hard to describe and only sort of comes to you once you start listening for it and then really let the music get in your bones that way. But that's absolutely the thing that blows me away the most about the music of this record, aside from just, you know, being able to pull apart drums, bass, and guitar, and all of them are individually great. But you don't usually get the level of cohesion that you are getting out of the backing band on this record. Backing band doesn't even feel like it really does it justice here. I mean, this is a straight up soul jam record. It's just that D'Angelo is the vocal.
Mm-hmm. The Dilla thing is really, really important. He has been cited since his passing. His star has really grown, and it's important to connect him to this record because of the influence that he had on giving people a new prism. Like, we talked about what a great producer Q-Tip was and how he took layers from different songs and turned them into a new cohesive thing. And he refracted years and years of influence of great soulful music in through a new prism. And Dilla did that at even more of a molecular level than that. Talked about how he would do like a 128 bar loop with no looping or quantizing. Like, he would play that all by hand. And I thought it was really great how Quest described learning about Slum Village and about Dilla. He described it as a messiah moment, that he and D'Angelo and Q-Tip had been looking for someone to lead us out of the darkness, to take us across the desert, and, you know, take those biblical implications for what you will. He said most of the time in those cases, you don't know who you're looking for until you see them. That's how people felt about Prince, or Jimi Hendrix before him, or about the Beatles, or about the Beach Boys. There wasn't a sound there. And then suddenly there was one. It's a magic trick. So, like, they didn't know what they were looking for until they pulled so far behind the beat that they were like, oh, this could be our thing. And again, Voodoo is a super appropriately titled name for this record, because it's like they conjured it, you know? They called on the spirits of their ancestors, and then boom. There it was, like some kind of black magic, which I can't underscore enough how badass an approach that is. That is not normal. There are shades of that, of, you know, relying on your influences, but to conjure it in that way is really special.
We mentioned already that they were spending a lot of time listening to old records and even playing through them. But let's dig into that analogy a little bit more about conjuring, because it almost feels like they were in a religious ceremony waiting on the magic to come. Like, they even talked about that, you know, the whole crew recorded hours of unreleased original material and covers of influencer material.
120 hours of 2-inch tape. There is so much music from these sessions just sitting in a room somewhere.
That's like when I found out that there are 2 alternate takes of the solo to Stairway to Heaven that none of us have heard before. And it's just like, where are these tapes?
Yeah.
But
it's like a lost book of the Bible almost.
Right. Except it would be fun to listen to. But like, one example was, you know, they were studying bootleg videotapes of classic R&B artists like Marvin Gaye and James Brown, watching Jimi Hendrix, watching reruns of Soul Train. And after watching a tape, they would play an album or a catalog or a jam from whatever they were watching for inspiration, right? It's starting to feel almost like they're in a circle, you know, just like, come to us. And like, so one example was that one night they played through Princess Parade until they flowed into a new groove that became Africa. Like, they would just do it and do it and do it until something appeared out of nowhere. And so much of this record is that way. That's one of the reasons I love it the most, is that like the songs are longer, not because they're making a point about song length, but because like they recorded so much music, to your point, and all of these songs are soul jams. That's it. And they're just starting it and cutting it off wherever it made the most sense. But they were writing this in a totally different way. Like, jamming doesn't do this justice as a phrase.
Right.
This was something diametrically different.
Like, there's jamming and then there's sampling in the way that Q-Tip showed that it could be done. And then there's this third thing that takes elements of both of those ideas, but all of a sudden it just pops up and reveals itself.
And that takes time, right? It takes a lot of time. And it takes someone with the approach and stubbornness, for lack of a better word, of D'Angelo to create enough space to do this, right? Because several people talked about how much contrast this record created to the music that was happening around it, right? And not just in a musical sense, and not just in like a farcical sense where like clearly this is different from an NSYNC record on its face, right? But on this level of, I will not go into the studio to produce something on a timeline to feed this machine of music. That's not how I can connect with my musical history.
Right.
And so it took years, and it took putting people in the same room, the literal same space, year over year, and recording that hundreds of hours of music to begin to make this happen.
There was a great quote in one of the articles about how hard it is to make it look that easy. They talked about how the result was ineffably natural, but they said that it's important to note that it requires copious God-given talent, which we've acknowledged the players on this have. We didn't mention the legendary Roy Hargrove playing on the horns, or Raphael Sadiq, who's had this incredible like banger after banger after banger, like chapter after chapter in his career as a writer, producer, songwriter, bandleader, all that. Like, he, Raphael Sadiq, deserves his own chapter on this podcast at some point. So copious God-given talent and constant woodshedding to pull that off, right? Like, putting in the reps, James Brown in the JB style, Prince in the Revolution style. There are no shortcuts. Like, you cannot manufacture, you cannot quantize your way to this result. This is the hours and the soul put together. You can't fake the real thing. That even applies to the engineering of the record. Super, super low end. There's a lot of space in the recording. Primarily the things that you hear are the bass and the kick drum, and they're kind of anchoring. And again, they're pulling you back and down. And then D'Angelo's vocals are typically in the higher register and really up front in the mix and kind of high in your head when you're listening in headphones. A lot of it was recorded live without overdubs, using pretty much all analog gear, and there's like almost a fetishism to it. But at the time of its release, like, the vinyl resurgence hadn't happened, so that was a very out of step move for the time. But Elevato, the engineer, said that he went after, quote, the blunted vibe of 60s and 70s psychedelia. He cited Zeppelin, the Beatles, Pink Floyd, Hendrix, Miles Davis as his influence. They were all soul and rock bass, and he wanted to make records that sounded like that. So he's even coming from a different triangulation point and contributing a different thing to this, putting it in the lineage of classic records of like, well, okay, they're going for a classic thing. I should as well. You know, this should be mentioned in the same conversation as a Zeppelin 4 or a Dark Side of the Moon or a Kind of Blue or an Are You Experienced? And to my knowledge, it really doesn't get talked about like that, but it should. Like, this is Dark Side of the Moon 2000. This is a holy shit, the planets have aligned type of a thing, and it is extraordinarily cosmic.
Sometimes it seems like maybe the only reason we're not having that conversation more often, or at least weren't prior to the release of Black Messiah, you know, nearly 15 years later, mm-hmm. is because what D has to say about it, that like he got pretty immediately misunderstood as a result of this, right? Which is, again, is funny because this is definitely the opposite of my experience in life, where he was essentially, like you've said, a music nerd who sat behind a piano and was shy and was a little overweight. And then this dude takes, in 3 months, hires a nutritionist and weight trainer and looks like the guy who's on the cover of the record for Voodoo now. Then shoots the video for Untitled, where he's essentially naked. And now he has a...
And you're like, oh, you can get muscles there?
Right. And now he's got a problem he didn't want to have. Now he's too sexy. Seriously. He's going off trying to do shows about Voodoo, and he's getting yelled at to take his shirt off. Women are literally fighting over front row seats to come see him. There was one story of two celebrities fighting and one of them threatening to push the other over a balcony over a seat, which is just incredible. And I say this with a twinkle in my eye, I guess, but like, he's upset about it to the point to where he's like, I gotta pull away.
Yeah.
I can't even do this because I'm one step down this road and I'm already not okay with it. They're not understanding what I did. Yeah, and he pulled back away. And
like you said, too pure.
I mean, wow.
The liner notes for the reissue in 2012 when they reissued it on vinyl, Jason King did a superb job telling the story, like a Ta-Nehisi Coates, Ture level of capturing the cultural moment. The title of his essay is The Time is Out of Joint. Everything about this is in defiance of time, right? Literally, rhythmically, it drags behind the beat. It refuses to be in time. D goes against or pulls deliberately behind the beat of the capitalist music industry, taking a long time between Brown Sugar and this record and an even longer time before the next one. Out of step with current trends, right? Emphasis on analog. And other than the Red Man and Method Man verse on Left and Right, a very, at the time, progressive embrace of femininity that gets talked about a number of different ways. They described it as being an Aquarian age type of thing. A lot of the people that played on this record are under the Aquarius sign. And then the songs are long. A lot of them are 6 minutes plus. They're jammy and kind of seem like they fade in and fade out, and you kind of almost come in the middle of them. Slow tempos, mostly sub 100 BPM in an era of 120 plus, and a 79-minute runtime in an era when we're starting to burn CDs. And this was like right on the cusp of, you know, there were only the 74-minute CDRs for a while, and then they got the 80-minute CDR. But either way, absolutely stuffing the thing to the gills, like the absolute limitation of what could be released in a physical format at that time. God knows if that record had come out now, how long it would be. It'd be, you know, it'd maybe be 160 minutes. It'd be a whole Prince double album. That's the thing that's really fascinating to me is D'Angelo's artist statement is that the thing we're going for, the love of the music points you to a place that is beyond time, that's out of step with the world, that beauty doesn't need those bounds or those things to lock you in. It's beautiful to me, the way that he makes that statement and executes it.
I agree that this output is beautiful. I also love that we can talk on one level about how they managed to conjure this beauty and creativity, and on the other hand, how literal and specific production choices and songwriting choices led to this thing and this feeling and this kind of moment in time. And I, like we've already joked, we could spend a really long time talking about individual things in a different world, in a format that was not a podcast, in which we would have to spend so much time doing it. I would love to treat this to a song by song, track by track,
mm-hmm.
where essentially we would, instead of talking, just play the entire album and then go, that was Play a Player. Now to the next one. And that's all you need to know. There are so many gems that you can get out going track by track. And one thing I want to leave our listeners with is maybe one additional way to listen to this record. We try to talk about different ways to listen to music, and especially when we come up against records that can take you in directions and down rabbit holes, which are fun. We've definitely talked about that there's really no middle territory here between, do you want this to be the best music you've ever heard before, or do you want a history lesson? If you go the history lesson route, there's so much material from the individuals between Questlove, Pino Palladino, and D'Angelo, and everyone else who was involved, who will happily tell you so many details about songs. But it's so great to listen to this record, and I'm never a person to say this, but it's even shuffleable in the sense that sometimes it's nice just to get a random song from this
and hear it in a new way.
Yeah, and then start marking down the places where, like, you were really blown away by something interesting they did, mm-hmm. and then go read about it. There's so much actual documentation about what went into these songs that it's really rare. And some of that's because of, you know, all the people who were involved in the time or at the time. Some of it's because of how much documentation was literally done at the time. Like, Saul Williams' liner notes from this record are themselves amazing.
So good.
For instance, like, Playa Playa, just starting right there at the beginning, like, Pino Palladino talks about how he was thinking about Stevie Wonder in the choruses and P-Funk in the verses. These little details that get peppered throughout all these songs, not only do you get so much musical history about where they come from and then how they were recorded, but then also you get this unique glimpse into real live earth-shaking professional musicians and what they were conceptualizing when they wrote this music and when they were jamming it out. To me, a couple of specific moments that I think are worth pointing out, if for no other reason than to play the amazing clips from it. I mentioned Playa Playa. I wanted to find out more about what Pino Palladino is thinking when I don't know what his hands are doing at any time, but he's an amazing musician to focus on individually. And then in Send It On, about 3 minutes in, they do, and so much of this is just jazz in a new context, mm-hmm. but they do this turn. You don't expect the song to shift in a way. And like, it sort of plays with your sense of when a song is going to begin and end because of how long the songs are. Your brain thinks the song has been going on for long enough and it's over now. And you get this whole new progression and direction in the song, and it keeps going. And there are so many of these little amazing moments that happen, again, only because they were willing to totally forget the format and bring the funk. Mm-hmm. And then just as an entire song, there's no way that I can skip over Spanish Joint, which itself is, it feels almost out of left field for this record too, but it's not. It's really hard to describe yet again because it's got a totally different flavor. The rhythm itself is almost unexpected, but yet not out of place at all. You can almost start to feel them by that point in the record of like, did something just inspire Questlove to start playing like this? And then the other profoundly fantastic musicians were like, well, that's easy, let's do it. Mm-hmm. And then they wrote this incredible song where, I mean, I had to stop walking one of the times when I was listening to it just so that I could hear the interplay between bass and guitar specifically on that song. We've never been brave. Feel this way. Little something to get me through this day. Give me a look at that. Don't talk bad. Yeah. Won't it be a good day? Yeah. Yeah. Everybody need. The two things that you talked about, like the funk energy, the really up tempo, and then going back to the playing behind the beat, the best example of those, in my opinion, is Chicken Grease, which came out of a Curtis Mayfield groove. They were grooving on Mother Son by Curtis Mayfield. And from that
was Chicken Grease, which was originally a jam that was going to be on Common's record. And D said to Questlove, I don't want to be an Indian giver, but there's no way he's walking away with that beat. And the story that Quest told was they named it Chicken Grease because of a phrase that Prince uses when he wants his guitarist to play a ninth minor chord while playing 16th notes. So it's a Curtis Mayfield groove with an explicitly Prince move. Like, the specificity of that, you said before we started recording, is unbelievable. But then it goes into my favorite song on the record, which is One Mo' Gin, which also has a moment toward the end where it goes into like kind of an up-tempo funk turn. But Pino plays so far behind. The bass on this is so syrupy, and it's the best bass line moment of the record, in my opinion. Other than maybe Untitled, which I think is rightfully the single from this record, but also the most explicitly one artist thing. It, like, it's a Prince song. And that moment comes to bear toward the end, like 6 minutes on, when he does the Prince full throat vocal, and then it just cuts off. Reminded me of the end of the Childish Gambino record when he just kind of cut it off in the middle. Awaken My Love by Childish Gambino, another record that like is explicitly channeling the spirit of its forebears. And, you know, say what we will about all the great rock and roll music throughout time, like that's a decidedly Black experience, a way to reconnect to things that you may not have otherwise been able to be connected to. So there is like an Afro consciousness to this record and others like it. But One Mo' Gin, man, that's one that like when the sun goes down, I can leave that on repeat one for hours and hours and hours. And there's that great Roberta Flack cover. Super good. He's really good at covers. Like, you can go find those covers from the soundtracks. My favorite soundtrack turn from D'Angelo, and honestly, the way that I found out about him, and I'm not ashamed to admit it, is from the Nautic, from the Men in Black soundtrack that interpolates the chorus.
The good Men in Black.
That soundtrack was incredible, and I think a lot of the people that we've mentioned had a hand in curating it and creating music for it, but he's great at covers. There's that great cover of Smokey Robinson's Cruisin' on Brown Sugar, and then he takes the Roberta Flack song, which is up-tempo and breezy, and he kind of stretches it out like the Justin Bieber slowed down 800% thing on YouTube and turns it into another dimension entirely.
To the funk energy point, with all due respect, and I mean that, to Donald Glover, and we spent a whole episode giving due respect, I think it's clear he could have never done what was done here vocally. And so you get on Awaken My Love, you get the funk energy in a more cathartic sense. Like, I'm going to give myself to this and I'm happy to yell, essentially. And yet, you know, not only is D'Angelo endlessly talented from a vocal and musical perspective, but it's also interesting because he channels that energy not into necessarily his vocal performance, but into how the vocals were recorded and then produced on the record itself, where sometimes just simple sentences and articles make me really happy. But, quote, the album features aggressive multi-tracking of D'Angelo's voice. But they call out that that's a technique similar to like Sly and the Family Stones, There's a Riot Going On, Let's Get It On, and that the multi-tracking affected the clarity of D'Angelo's voice. So if you're listening to this record, kind of like he's a great singer, but it sounds weird in the mix. It's sort of on purpose. And even that is sort of channeling the things that he was trying to conjure from before. And so it's sort of this intentional obfuscation on top of it, so that it's a soul record, but it's funk, right? Mm-hmm. And so these different ways that he manages to integrate these things into one piece are amazing, even to the point to where, like, one of my favorite bits from the liner notes we mentioned from Saul Williams, during part of it, he speaks to this use of multi-tracking, and he says, "You might respond, lyrics? Yo, I can't even understand half the shit that D'Angelo is saying. That dude sounds like Bobby McFerrin on opium." And I would say, "You're right, neither can I. But I am drawn to figure out what it is and what he's saying. His vocal collaging intrigues me."
Yeah.
And like, that was the point, right? Drawing you in, trying to get you to listen to something with a different level of specificity, instead of doing the, like, it's neo soul for a reason, right? It's not adult contemporary. If he wanted to make a Celine Dion record and make it sound like that, he could have, and his vocals could have been single track, extremely clear, extremely precisely recorded, and sitting well above the mix, so that the band would be a backing band. Like, he could have easily made that record, and he didn't on purpose, because he wanted you to know something along with everybody else who made this record. And like, that's just, that's the gift that keeps on giving. Like, that circle never ends. You can keep coming back to moments like that here. And to your point, the more we talk about this record, it's like, why are we not talking about this record more? Why doesn't this come up more? And like, why does everything literally pale in comparison to it when you spend some time with it?
It casts a spell on you. I'm sitting here kind of watching us as a third person in the studio, and we're working ourselves into a little bit of a religious fervor, and we did.
Yeah, I'm like upset.
On the ride over to the studio. I'm so intrigued by this idea of this record having a supernatural quality. And, you know, the album artwork really draws out the voodoo imagery of the record. And for some people, that would just add mystique. But I think that's another part of the history lesson D'Angelo is trying to point us to, because voodoo has African origins, and it was feared by slave owners, and it ignited the Haitian Revolution of 1791, I read. But D'Angelo was the son of a Pentecostal minister and the grandson of a church elder. So he has always been deeply steeped in the power of the Holy Spirit, so to speak, you know, especially the Pentecostal world, the speaking in tongues, the healing. There's this incredible interview Amy Wallace did in 2012 for GQ, and a lot of it centers on religion and the Holy Spirit. And he said, "I learned at an early age that what we were doing in the choir was just as important as the preacher. The stage is our pulpit, and you can use all of that energy and that music and the lights and the colors and the sound. But, you know, you got to be careful." And she said, "Coming out of D's mouth, this is more than hokum. He believes it, and he makes you believe it. There are many ghosts hidden within this record. They're still being drawn out." So if it sounds like this record is attuned to the Holy Spirit, so to speak, I mean, let it fill you with the Holy Ghost, man.
We mentioned Solange earlier. I think she said what you're saying really well, maybe even more concisely in an affrontive type of way. But she said, "Voodoo is the church in which we all come to worship the religion of soul music. It is the word. It is the temple. It is the law for all lovers of true rhythm and blues."
Amen. Go to tunedig.com for your chance to win, and follow us on Instagram and Twitter for more info about the album that didn't make the episode.